4, verse 4, when the fullness of the time was come, God sent forth his son. Christmas is just around the corner. Across the world, billions will be spent, celebrations will be held, millions of travelers will travel uncounted miles to feast with family and kin. It's the biggest celebration in the Western world. But I have a question. What is so significant in world affairs to justify such outlay and effort? Stores close, schools shut down, parliaments recess, special stamps are issued. Bah humbug was Scrooge's response, but multiplied millions decorate trees and light candles and make plum puddings and tuck children into bed on the evening of December the 24th, assuring them that a little elf by the name of Santa Claus is going to visit them during the night. There's nothing in society to compare with this. It's bigger than Canada Day and Veterans Day and Halloween and Valentine's Day all rolled into one. And we have a right to ask what is so huge as to be celebrated in this way by so many. The answer is found in 2,000 years of human history and in the conviction by millions that something enormous took place in Bethlehem 2,000 years ago. You don't have to believe it, of course. You can even have pity on the simpletons who do believe it, but that doesn't apparently change anything. For you still buy the colored paper, and you hang up the mistletoe, and you mix the apple cider. Some people say it's just a myth, a throwback to times of superstition. But I have a right to ask why a myth, God itself so rooted in history and literature and music, as to result in today's festivities. Well, here are the facts. As I understand them, a personal God spoke our universe into existence. Lonely for fellowship, God made man in his own image and likeness. He placed man in a garden surrounded by beauty and gave him a lovely partner to be his companion. There was but one stipulation: they must not eat of the fruit of the tree in the midst of the garden. Fellowship with God was at stake. Obey and live, or disobey and forfeit everything worth having. Well, I'm not indulging in fantasy here. I'm reading the record. Temptation led to sin, and sin led to its consequences. And man, ejected from Eden, fought with mosquitoes and thistles and angina, and earned his bread by the sweat of his brow, and grew old until he returned to the dust from which he had been made. Oh, there's a shaft of light in all of this. God said, Genesis 3:15, the seed of the woman will bruise the serpent's head. Adam gave way to Enoch, and Enoch to Noah, and Noah to Abraham as the centuries rolled by. God talked to Abraham, then he gave tablets of stone to Moses, and then he fed Israel in the wilderness. And then Joshua conquered Jericho, but the seed of the woman did not yet bruise the serpent's head. David became king. Isaiah wrote his prophecy. Ezekiel preached to refugees by the river Chebar, but the seed of the woman did not yet bruise the serpent's head. And then one day, Gabriel spoke to a lovely girl called Mary in Nazareth and told her that the time had come, and she was the virgin who would conceive and bear a son whose name would be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. This son that she would bear would be without human father and would be Emmanuel, God with us. You see, God was about to visit his world and redeem his lost creation. Do you know the story, or are you hearing it today for the first time? Caesar at Rome decided that the entire world should be taxed. Despite the fact that Mary was great with child, she and Joseph traveled the long dusty miles from Galilee down to the sleepy little town of Bethlehem, David's royal city, there to be taxed. And there was no room in the inn, so that night Mary gave birth to her baby and laid her tiny son on a blanket on the straw in the manger. Shepherds nearby were told that the greatest event in history was taking place, and so they came to worship. Also, wise men from the east followed a star that they might come to worship. It was the birthday of a king, heaven's crown prince, God's only son. And he then grew, increased in wisdom and stature and favor with God and men. He made ox yokes in the carpenter shop in Nazareth. And then one day, the wilderness prophet John the Baptist shouted his welcome, "Behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world." Follow the story. He healed, he saved, he blessed, and then, accused of blasphemy, he was nailed to a cross. But the third day he rose again, declaring himself to be the Son of God with power by the resurrection from the dead. I'm trying, my dear friend, the best I can to tell you why today, this year, around the world, tens of millions close their shops and close their books and travel amazing miles to sit with family at festive tables to celebrate. When the fullness of the time was come, God sent forth his son into the world. People who were convicted by a broken law, he came to redeem us. Heaven's gate was opened. The Redeemer had come. There was a Savior. Of course, I believe that the great God of heaven became my Savior, and all God's fullness dwelleth in him. I believe that Jesus is the heir of all things. I believe that he is the one by whom God made the worlds, and so I worship. I believe Isaiah 9, verse 6, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son. I believe John chapter 1, verse 1, in the beginning it was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. I believe Hebrews 1, verse 1, that God has spoken to us by his Son. I believe Colossians 2, verse 9, that in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. Christmas is the day on which I look up to the sky and thank my Heavenly Father that he so loved us that he sent his Son to be our Savior, that he took our sin and sorrows upon himself on the cross and paid the price that we could not pay so that we might have hope and assurance of eternal life. Millions observe Christmas. Jesus, who was rich, for our sakes became poor so that we might be rich in him, rich in the forgiveness of our sins, rich in fellowship with God, and rich in absolute assurance of heaven hereafter. May I talk directly to you at this Christmas season? Have you received God's love gift to the world? He gave his Son when the fullness of time was come to redeem us. We had gone astray. We had broken his law. We were condemned and guilty. But he died. He died in my place so that I might live forever in his place in the Father's kingdom. Come and go with me to the Father's house where there's peace, sweet peace. You can know the Prince of Peace Simply open your heart. Simply invite him to come in. He's waiting to bless you.
Box 426, Winnipeg, Manitoba, R36.